It's a great day. It's a special day. And I sense that, don't you?
Yes.
Today we are beginning a series, as you know, under the title God's Big Picture. That is the title of the book that we're using as the basic structure of the teaching that we're beginning today. God's Big Picture is a book that's available to you. It's in our bookstore. It's on special this month, all during this series. You can avail yourself. We also have this book. I'm sorry our warehouse isn't full of these languages, but just to excite you about how this message has rather taken on a life of its own and is being spread around the world, I want you to look at these books that are all God's Big Picture in various languages. Everything from Japanese, Chinese, French, Spanish, Mizo, Burmese, Indonesian, Russian, Portuguese, and this is just some. And the reason this is in so many languages is because the message, as it's presented as God's Big Picture, has become so useful to believers, actually unbelievers as well, in getting a grasp on the totality of Scripture. If all you ever know of Scripture is you study Daniel, and then you study David and Goliath, and then you study Jesus and he healed the blind man, and then you study Paul and he went on missionary trips. If that's all you know, oh yeah, there's end times and there's lots of stuff in between. If that's all you know, the Bible is rather a confusing book. And in essence, we miss the power that is in the Scripture, the one story of Scripture. So God's Big Picture is the one story of Scripture that's all about God and his plan for humanity. And that's what we're going to focus on during this teaching. Now, you who are here with us today, we are going to enjoy this study time together. This is a teaching series, so you need your Bibles, you need to have your mind open, your hearts open, and be ready to absorb and apply what you learn. But I'm also excited that some of you are watching us live stream. Right now, you're with us, and we're so happy. But I want to extend my welcome to you who will experience this teaching way beyond today. Months, years from now, you will be sitting in front of your computer holding some mobile device. You will be somewhere in some corner of this earth and you will begin to learn about God and his plan for you. So we're so excited that we're able to capture these teachings in order to spread them around the world. Now, Heavenly Father, we present ourselves to you, knowing that it's through people that you've chosen to convey your message of love and good news. We thank you for your word that gives us your truth in a way that by the power of your Spirit, we can understand your plan for people. So we dedicate this series to you and this time of study to you, that we will accomplish what you desire in the hearts of people. In the name of Jesus, everyone say amen.
Amen.
Now, as we begin, I want to create a rather a backdrop. Jesus said to the woman who had come to him and touched him, the woman who was ill, he said to her, "Your faith has made you well." And this introduces an idea that is important to us, and it answers really a question: why do we study a topic such as we're approaching today? It simply means that what we experience in our lives is based on what we know. So the things of God, the things that are provided to us through Christ, all of the good news that comes to us through Jesus Christ, can only be experienced if we know about it. We've got to know about it. And so because of the importance of us knowing so that we can believe, so that we can experience, is reinforced in some scriptures that I want to share with you. And I've chosen these because they use the wonderful word that is an all-inclusive word that we'll that you'll recognize right away. I begin in Matthew chapter 4, verse 23. Now Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all their sicknesses and all kinds of disease among the people. So he came preaching the gospel. And then we go over to Matthew 24. Jesus now is speaking to his disciples, and he says, beginning verse 14, this gospel, that word again, of the kingdom, will be preached in all the world as a witness to all nations, and then the end will come. So Jesus not only came preaching the gospel, but he commanded his disciples, he said that it's this gospel that will be preached as a witness. That's going to happen before there is the end. So therefore we run with the message. And then we continue on to Mark 16:15, and Jesus again speaking to his disciples, and this is the command that continues and includes all of us. He said, chapter 16, verse 15, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He goes on to say, everyone who believes and is baptized will be saved, and those who do not believe are already condemned. So this is a very, very important idea, that there is a message that Jesus came preaching. There is a message that must be preached in all the earth. There is a message that we've been commanded to preach. There is a message that is so much at the core of our faith that then we can understand the words of Paul in Romans chapter 1, verse 16. And this, I guess this is one of my favorite scriptures. I identify with it, with everything in me. He says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. I'm telling you, my friends, we have to come to the place that we really understand this gospel. We embrace it for ourselves, and we're not ashamed of it. For it, this gospel of Jesus Christ, it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes. Yes, the Jew first, and also to us who are Gentiles. So again, we're seeing throughout these various places in Scripture an emphasis on this idea, the gospel. We know linguistically that's a Greek word translated English as gospel. It just means good news. Good news. So I want to talk to you this morning about this gospel that is the one story of Scripture. All of the Scripture is a good news story. When you understand the gospel, you can open it anywhere, find any passage, and you're going to see good news. I promise you. If all you see is bad stuff, it's because you don't know the gospel. We're going to talk about this. So few people truly understand the gospel. They may say, oh, the gospel is the story about Jesus dying on the cross, shedding his blood so that my sins could be forgiven, and so when I die, I'll go to heaven. Wouldn't you say a lot of people would answer that way? And that's not untrue, but that's a minuscule part of the entire story. We have to understand the entire story. What is the gospel? Well, that's what this series is about. The gospel can be conveyed to us in four events. And, of course, that's the way this book is laid out, God's big picture. But don't be hung up on the word event, although I love the word event, because each event was a point in time, documented on the calendar, something in time, something happened that was part of God's story. But you could also call it God's big picture. You could call it the story of Scripture. You could call it the plan of salvation. You could call it God's plan for humanity. You could call it many things. I'm choosing to call it the gospel of redemption. The good news about what God did through Christ to redeem us back to himself. That is the point of the story. So we're going to look at this idea of redemption. It, you see, is the foundation, the knowledge of redemption. What God did through Christ. Can I say that again? I want to make sure you understand. When we use the word redemption, that's a Bible-sounding word. It's a theological word. It can be a cliche. We just throw out redemption, redemption. Yeah, we love redemption. Yeah, we're people of redemption. But that's not good enough. We have to understand what it means. I'm defining it for you. Redemption, yes, it means the action of buying back, paying a ransom, restoring. Yes. Redeem, to redeem. Something once you had and then you lost it and then you redeem it so you have it back again. Yes, it means that. But the message of redemption is in essence what God did through Christ on behalf of all people. That's redemption. And you see, that's why it's so important. If it was important for God to be involved, it must be important. If it was big enough for all people, it must be important. If Jesus is the center of all of that, then it must somehow be very important to our faith as Christians, we who believe in Jesus Christ. So redemption, the message of redemption, the truths of redemption are the foundation for all biblical and spiritual truth. That's a bold statement. That means that if you think you believe something from Scripture, if it's not grounded on the truths of redemption, it is not correct interpretation of Scripture. It's just that simple. Redemption is the foundation. There is no other foundation. If we build on any other, our teachings are faddish, they are temporary, they are shallow, they are inaccurate, they are partial, but when our teachings are grounded on the foundation of redemption, they're solid. They will stand the test of time. They will work. They will bring consistency and maturity and balance to our lives, and we will live lifestyles of success, of happiness, of joy, of peace, of purpose, of dignity. We will become the embodiment of God's plan for humanity. Hallelujah. So it's a big subject. It's a big subject. Redemption, or God's big picture. It's the overview of his plan, and that's what we're focusing on. It satisfies our need to understand the scripture from Genesis to Revelation. If you're never able to go to Bible school and you study with me the truths of redemption through God's big picture, you will understand the Bible and nothing will be a mystery to you. Do you understand? Yes. If you do go to seminary or Bible schools as I have, you will find out that it's these truths that fill in the cracks and that puts the pieces together so all of a sudden everything makes sense. You have one big picture of God and his truth and his plan and where you fit into it. Thank you, Jesus. So if we think about the one story of Scripture, God's big picture, the gospel, that it's about Christ, what God did through Christ for us, then we need to, first of all, understand why he did what he did. And that takes us back way, way to the beginning. And that's where we begin this morning. The first chapter in this story begins with God's creation. Now, when we think about, yes, we're referring to a book, but think of it more broadly than that. Think about a play with four scenes. Think about it as a song with four verses. Think about it as a picture or a portrait that unfolds. unfolds in a linear way. The unfolding picture, that's the way it is in the scripture. We start at page 1, and the story unfolds page 3, page 20, page 200. That's the way we must approach the Bible, as one story. Don't be confused by chapters and verses and names of books. The scripture, this library of books, 66 books, is conveying one story. One story. And if we get that one story, everything else makes sense. God's creation. Well, if we're going to begin with God's creation, we have to go to the book of what? The book of Genesis. And we're going to begin in the very beginning, page 1. I'm sorry if you can see my Bible. I've got it so taped, the pages will hardly lay down. Because I actually wear out my Bibles when Genesis 1 and 2 is worn out. And by the time we're finished with this series, you're going to understand why Genesis 1 and 2 is so important and why we keep going back there. We don't start our study of anything in Corinthians or Revelation or Daniel or, no, not even Matthew. No, we have to start it in Genesis. We want to know what God's plan is for us today. Listen to me. You want to know God's plan for you today, you've got to go back. And I would say, when you understand these things, a lot of your prayers, God, what do you want for me, will be answered. A lot of that confusion that, especially as young people, we have. I remember when I was young, and I was so, it's been a while, I would almost say I was preoccupied with knowing the will of God and what he wanted me to do. Raised in a family of such purpose and focus on evangelism. I loved the Lord. I wanted to please him. I accepted him at an early age, at the age of 7. I was baptized in the Holy Spirit at the age of 9. I felt a call to full-time ministry, although I have to admit I didn't know what that was. I just thought everything I did after that was ministry. So whether I was emptying the trash or talking to my friend about Jesus, I thought it was all ministry. Right. But the point was, I was, because of my desire to serve the Lord, and because of the confusion that was going on in church teaching at the time, I just thought it would be practically impossible to know the will of God for my life. It was like a big mystery, and how was I ever going to know? I was just a kid, and this big God and this big thing you want to please, and you don't know quite how to fit in. You just know your heart tugs that direction. I'm telling you, if I'd have known then what I know now, and what young people now are learning, everything could have been so much more peaceful. Because when you understand God's original plan and you work through this unfolding story, you discover that what God wants for you now is what he always wanted for you. And that's the key, that we look at Genesis 1 and 2 not like an ancient history recitation with maybe no dates, but quotes and sequences of events. If that's the way we look at it, it's very little relevance to our lives. But when we dig into it, saying, this was your plan, and it's always been your plan, and you never changed your mind, I don't know how you can do this in me, but nevertheless, if this is your plan, I want to understand it. Right. Now, if we approach the study this way, then this is so, so relevant to our lives. Amen. Now, the reason chapter 1 and 2 of Genesis is so important, they are the only two chapters in the entire scripture that talk about what happened before sin. Think about it. Everything else in scripture is about sin, or the jam we got us in, the problems that occurred because of our choices, and of God's dealing with humanity, trying to show himself and guide them rightly, and Jesus coming in the dramatic work of salvation, and then how people learn to live this Jesus life on through as documented in the New Testament. You see, if that, all of that is because there was sin. If there had never been sin, I guess we would only need chapter 1 and 2. But on the other hand, we wouldn't even need chapter 1 and 2 because we would be so spiritually tuned to God and his spirit. We would be like one spirit, communicating spirit to spirit. we wouldn't really need to go and turn to. So that's why Genesis 1 and 2 is important. It's still words on paper that help teach us, but it's taking us back so that we can kind of clear the slate and imagine, what was it in the beginning? What was it like before the complication and the contamination and confusion of sin began to imprint on humanity? That's why we go there. Now, I want to talk to you this morning, and from Genesis 1 and 2, I want to talk to you about God's pattern. God's purpose, person, God's purpose, and God's plan. God's person. God's person, God's purpose, and God's plan. Now, these are important kind of handles you can hold on to as you reflect on our study today. Because what I'm approaching with you is very vast. It's very vast. And I cannot in one session cover everything that I want to that covers God's creation. But this is going to give you an insight, a place upon which you can build. It starts with God's person. This is very important. Verse number one. Genesis number one. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. We are now introduced to God's person. The first three verses of the scripture are introducing us to God so that we understand who he is, because if we're made in his image, we need to understand his image. We can't just start with us. We have to start with him. So while I cannot do a complete exegetical study on the Godhead, I have to just show you this simple way to understand the person of God. The person of God. In verse 1, we are introduced to what we can call God the Father. God the Father, the originator of all things. He created. Everything came out of him. The idea, the original, the action as Father, we're introduced to immediately. Everything that's created has come through him. Right. We see that in Scripture. Verse 2, the earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. Now we are introduced to God as Spirit, that hovering presence. The presence that yet abides, that is yet present in the earth. Yes, he lives in us as born-again believers, but we know his presence is everywhere, every place that hovering presence continues to exist. Verse number 3, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. And now we're introduced to God as word, creative word, or because we understand the rest of the story, the Son, God the Son, the one who the scripture refers to as the one who was in the beginning with God, who was with God, who was God, and through whom all things were made, and nothing was made that exists except it was made by him, that word that became flesh and dwelt among us. Gospel of John, chapter 1, read it again and reflect on Genesis 1. We're introduced to God as Word, the Son, the one who comes and puts a face on God, who manifests God to us. Hallelujah. So first three verses tell us who God is. So this is God's person, that God the Father, the originator. God the Spirit, the hovering presence. And many, many, many more things. I'm trying to give you essence this morning. God the Word or the Son, he is both the creator and the recreator. Is it any wonder that it was the Word who became flesh to dwell among us and to become the sacrifice for our sin so that he could recreate us after the model of the original design? He was the one. He knew how to do it. He created from the beginning, and he comes to recreate us with his own life. So when we think about God's person, we think about plurality. Get this principle. Plurality expressed in perfect unity. Now, you see, this is a concept that is very hard for our Western minds. Because so much is based on mathematics. And 1 + 1 + 1 does not equal 1. But in God's math system, 1 + 1 + 1 = 1. Or we could say it this way, what God ordained in the beginning as Father, he provided through Christ as Son and manifests in the world today as Spirit. So simple. Don't complicate it. But grasp this idea. One author that I love very much, Dr. Gilbert Bilezikian, he has written a book titled Community 101. And that's a wonderful term also that expresses the unity of this Godhead, community of one. Community of one. When we think about God as not just a singular entity, but of a one that is complex, that is awesome, that is beyond description, that is amazing. That is the God that we know as person to us, personality, God. And so we begin with this idea of God's person, and that is where we must begin. Now, let's continue with this idea and go into the concept of God's purpose. What was God's purpose from the beginning? You see, all these things I'm talking to you about are still true today. God's person has not changed. The Lord says, I am the Lord, and I do not change. Scripture says, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. So God's person does not change. We need to understand him. Likewise with God's purpose. God's purpose has never changed. All of creation, think about it. Because when you read past verse 3 of Genesis 1, all the way really through verse 25, you're going to be reading about the creation, the stars, the moon, the dividing light and darkness, the waters from the dry land, the plant life, the animal life, the birds of the air, all of the things that are created. You're going to read about them. All of that is here. But all of creation, think of it that way, all of creation, all of these things that we marvel at, according to Isaiah 45, verse 18, listen to this. For this is what the Lord says. He who created the heavens, he is God. He who fashioned and made the earth, he founded it. He did not create it to be empty, but formed it to be inhabited. He says, I'm the Lord, and there's no other. Now, if you study our complete redemption courses, there are 52 lessons, and they're available online. If you speak English, they're available online at osborn.org. But what you discover throughout Scripture is that everything that God created was created for his human family. It was created. The sun didn't need to be in the sky for just to make light. It was for us. We have seasons. We need to grow things. We need to eat. We need to be sustained. The wealth of the earth was placed there by God for the use of his children. So when you think about the greatness of the creation, remember that It was all for God's human creation. Remember that. I don't care. I don't care what status of life you see yourself. I don't care what people say about you. I don't care how much money is in your bank account. I don't care whether you have a job or not. I don't care if your car runs well or not. I don't care if folk around you think you're wealthy or poor. None of it matters. God created everything that exists for you. For you. And that is something to start chewing on and understanding and embracing when we think about God's purpose. Secondly, his purpose was to be expressed in the physical realm. We know that God is spirit. John 2:24 teaches us God is spirit. Spirit can't be seen. Spirit has to be expressed. Spirit has to be. Do you ever wonder why demons like to possess people? All spirits want expression. God, the spirit of love and mercy, compassion, the spirit, love oozing out of the very essence of who he is as spirit, yearns for expression. So God's original purpose was to be expressed in the physical realm. See, you weren't created just because God wanted little people to boss around or to scare. You weren't created because God was bored and needed playthings. You weren't created so God could have puppets that he makes do things whether they want to or know what they're doing. No. No. Don't insult God with those kind of ideas. God is love. God is spirit. Yearns to be expressed in a physical, where he can be seen. He's a relational God. He's a relational God. He wants relationship. He wants to be understood in a realm that can come and touch, that can feel, can look, can communicate, can discuss. Do you understand? Can identify with. God is a God of relationship. He proves it in the creation. He created us to have communion with, that we remember his purpose, that he would be expressed. Again, I don't care, wealthy, poor, elevated or demeaned in your society, it doesn't matter. God created you to be an expression of him in this physical world. If that doesn't add dignity to your life, I don't know what does. To be expressed, we're here to express him. Remember, nothing has changed. When we understand what he wanted. Next, his purpose was to share his image and likeness. To share his image and likeness. Now, this is amazing, but this is where love kicks in. What does love like to do above all? Give. Share. Just give. If you love someone, you just want to give them something. It can be a little stone or a leaf. Or an embrace. You want to give something. Isn't it true? What was the most important thing God had to share? His image likeness. Who he is. He invested himself in his human creation. This is so amazing. And this is where the story continues in Genesis 1, 26 and 27. And in fact, going all the way through, we read that God is wanting to share his image. He said, let us make mankind in our own image, in our own likeness. There is a verse. Let me take you to Psalm. I'm intentionally not giving you 10,000 verses for everything, because you can imagine there's many verses for everything. But I want to show you this one in Psalm 8. This is a beautiful, beautiful verse, a psalm. And let me just pick up verse 3. When I consider your heavens and the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you've ordained, what is humankind that you are mindful of him or her, and the son of man and woman that you visit them? You have made them a little lower than, some translations say the angels, some translations say God. The word in the Hebrew is Elohim. So you have made them a little lower than yourself, than God. And you've crowned them with glory and honor and have made them to have dominion over the works of your hands. You've put all things under their feet. How excellent is your name in all the earth. Hallelujah. So God's purpose from the beginning was to impart, to share his image and likeness. Next, his purpose was to bless his human creation. And the story continues, chapter 1, pick it up, verse 28, and keep going. God's intention was to bless. The scripture says, so then, after he created them, he blessed them. Oh, my friends, learn something about God as we discover Genesis 1 and 2. He's not vengeful. He doesn't withhold. He doesn't play tricks. He's not complicated. He doesn't try to withhold himself. He communicates. He's clear. And he blesses. He blesses. He's a God of blessing. He blessed them and he said, be fruitful, multiply, fill the earth, subdue it. Have dominion over everything. The fish, the sea, everything I've created. Just be a steward of it. Have dominion. So we're talking about God creating everything for human creation. His purpose to express himself through us, to share his image with us, to bless us. Say, somebody say hallelujah. Hallelujah. And in verse 31, it says everything that God created was very good. And then finally, it was God's purpose to provide rest, the blessing of rest after labor. That's chapter 2, verse 2. So chapter 1, verse 1, all the way through chapter 2, verse 3, is the overview story of creation. You notice I added the blessing of rest after labor? That doesn't mean rest after being lazy. God doesn't bless rest with after lazy. He blesses rest after labor. He set the pattern. He worked 6 days and then he rested. And later he blessed the Sabbath. He blessed the day and gave it to us as a day of rest, a day of reflection, a day of focus. That's what today is. This is the Lord's day. This is a day we're around the Word of God, letting the cares of our regular day of the week pass by and just be on hold for a minute. Well, we enjoy the blessing of this day after having labored. Thank you, Jesus. Now we pick up Genesis chapter 2 at verse 3. And what we see in the remaining verses of chapter 2 are specifics about the creation. Chapter 1 plus 2 verses is overview. Chapter 2, beginning verse 3, we're focusing on some specifics, and this is what you notice in Scripture, that there will be an overview story. And then there will be some things, and some stories are only to make one point, to highlight something that's important for us to get. So that's the way we look at the rest of chapter 2, because it's in these verses that we discover what I'm calling God's plan. God's plan. Number one, and if we start reading, I don't have time to read all of it, but he talks about the history of creation. God blessed the seventh day. The history of the heavens was such and such. And he talks about rain hadn't come yet. Everything was watered by a mist that came up from the ground. And then verse 7. And the Lord God formed Adam. That's the Hebrew word, Adam. I'm just talking about a guy's name. The Lord formed Adam of the dust of the ground, Adama, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. Now, this one verse gives us a picture of something so profoundly important and relevant to our lives today as Spirit-filled believers. When you read Genesis 1, God calls from the earth. He calls from the earth. And then he says, let us. He talks to himself. Let us. And let's do this. And so he did. Now we peek here and we see how he did. And you get the image that God himself stoops. I don't know how God as spirit can stoop. But it's written in a way that we can imagine. That he stoops. His presence focuses on the dust of the ground. And out of that, he begins to fashion a human form. Now think about this. But that form is lifeless. And that's the picture of humanity without the life of God. You don't have to know anything about sin yet to understand God created, but it's not right because the life of God is not present. And so God himself, again, let's use the imagery of Scripture. He stoops and breathes into the nostrils. That's very specific. Breathes into the nostrils the breath of life. And I have to pause here just a moment to just let us just hover here with me. Let's understand what this means. It's so, so important because what he did is what caused us to be living beings. Not dogs, not monkeys, not turtles or birds, not worms. No. Living beings. The dogs were already taking in oxygen. The birds were already flying. But they weren't living beings. There's another dimension beyond breathing and a heart pumping to being a living being, which tells us today that you can be a form that's lifeless, that is not a living being, and yet your heart can beat, your lungs can breathe, you can go about like you're a normal human, but you're not a living being. That only comes when the life of God is able to be imparted to us. But that's later in the story. Hallelujah. Think about this. These two words are very important. Breath is the word that's used here. And I'm going to also, that word breath is neshama in Hebrew, but there's another word that is so closely associated, which is spirit. And many of the descriptions definitions of those two words, one is neshama, that is breath, the other is ruach, that is spirit. Those two are so closely associated. And if you know that God is spirit and he's breathing into, you understand why we put the word spirit in there in our study. If you consider these words, what does it mean? What did God breathe into us? And what does it mean? And what makes us a living being? These are some of the words. Listen to this. It means wind. Breath. Okay, we can get that one. Inspiration. This is divine inspiration. This is that something that causes electric ideas to flow that are God-like and that are God-originated. And we wonder, where did that come from? That's what God gave us. Intellect. You think you're just, because your mom and dad were smart, you've got intellect? No. You may have an IQ, it doesn't mean you've got God-level intellect. That's another level altogether. Soul. Our soul. You hear a lot of teachings today that call the soul another part of us. We've got a spirit, we've got a soul, we've got a mind. But it's just out of lack of understanding of the language. You see, these words, what God breathed in, he gave us a soul. He gave us a soul. He gave us spirit. Same thing, same word. Gave us spirit. We're God-like. Do you understand? Do you understand that as recipients of his life? I'm not talking about, let me just say it. Human beings all of humanity has been invested with spirit life potential. The life means that we will live forever. We have a beginning, but we don't have an end. Spirits are eternal. We will live forever. That's God gave us that. We're never going to die. The potential part means we have the potential of living forever in the presence of God or away from His presence. He has given us, not dogs, not birds, He's given us the potential of living forever with Him or not. But our spirits will live forever. Life. This is another interpretation of this word, life. No wonder we become animated after He breathed into us. Life, life, life. My father and I wrote a book together, New Miracle Life Now. We try to help people understand all over the world that there is a supernatural life, a divine life that is imparted to us. When we understand what Christ did for us and we come to believe and claim Him as our own Savior and Lord. A divine life. You don't get that by having a be good list. You don't have that by just being a religious person and doing all the religious things. Divine life is God's life, His breath that is imparted to us because that was His purpose, His plan in the beginning, and His plan has not changed. There's more understanding. You see, when God's life is in us, we don't have to be dense. We don't have to be like we're always, you know, that deer in a headlight. Internationals, you may not understand that. It's an animal that comes out on the road, and when our headlights flash in their eyes, they just stop. So that we hit them. And they just stare. So that's the look of a deer in the headlights. The idea is we don't have to go through life looking shocked. Oh, where am I? Am I supposed to run or stand still? No, we have understanding. Hallelujah. Another one. Listen, courage. You ever wonder why the saints of God are bold? Why they do things that other people sit back and go, ooh, how did they have the courage to do that? It's right here in Genesis 2. God has given us courage to fulfill His plan, to accomplish His purpose, to express His person. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. What about mind? Oh, we know later in study that we have the mind of Christ. But right here, it's part of that impartation of the God life. We have His mind. We have His essence. My friends, the breath of life. The breath of life. That is big. So God, His intention was through His plan to impart His divine life to His human creation. Secondly, to provide an environment. Now I'm coming on down because then God, beginning verse 8 of chapter 2, He planted a garden. And various things happen. He talks about the rivers. He talks about the tree of life, knowledge of good and evil. And He talks about these things. So it was His plan to provide an environment of provision and purpose. Provision and purpose. My father, of course, many of you would know, he grew up as a farmer. And he had never stopped thinking like a farmer. You know, a farmer plants seed. A farmer works the field. A farmer pulls the weeds. A farmer brings in the harvest. A farmer takes stuff to market. A farmer provides something for people to live on. The work of the farmer is so symbolic to the work of God through His people. But the idea is he always loved this image of God planting a garden. In fact, if you come to our house that we shared together for 14 years before he passed, you would see that he put a sign on his gate, Osborn Garden. Osborn garden. And he would work his garden, and he would plant things, and oh, it was beautiful. He loved to work in the garden. So he would often just sit back here in his dirty boots and his clothes and his dirt all over and his shovel and his clippers and all the stuff that a gardener would need. And he'd just stand back and smile and say, God couldn't do any better without, that we couldn't do any better than I've done. Look what God did through me. Look at this garden. God would be proud. So he always saw God as one who so wanted his children to be surrounded in beauty, in the fragrance of flowers, in the peaceful ambiance of a garden. That was the way my father saw it from this very scripture. So God's plan was to provide an environment of provision and purpose. And then when we talk about God's instruction, let's read it, verse 16. And 17, the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden you may eat freely. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat it, you'll surely die. And this is where we see that God's plan from the beginning was to allow his creation to exercise free will. Now, that's very important. That's very important. It's such a far-reaching concept, because when you think that God, from the very beginning, knowing everything, knowing how we would use our free will, knowing what extent he would have to go to rescue us from the consequences of our free will, he gave us free will. Now, let's ponder that a moment. God giving humanity free will means that God, as love, does not want us to love him or obey him or serve him out of coercion, out of fear, out of force, out of manipulation. No, 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 no. There are so many religions in the world that coerce people to obey. With fear, with threats, with promises, all kinds of things. My friends, that is not the God of love who created us in his image. He gave us free will because he loves us. And he wants us to love him back, to respond to him because we choose to. And we can call that faith. By faith, we decide you're good. You want only good for me. Look at how you've proven what you want for me. You've given me everything. You've even given me your own image and your breath. You've given me everything. Why would I not trust you? I'm going to trust you. And because I trust you, I'll do what you say. I will trust your words. I will believe who you are, who you say you are. I'll believe everything you say to me will be true. I trust you. I love you. You've only loved me. Now, that's what God wants. That's what he wanted then. That's what he wants now. There is no coercion. Don't ever come to Christ because you're afraid of what God will do to you. Don't insult him like that. No. Don't do that. Only come to him when you see that he's worth your love, worth your devotion, worth your life, that he's what you've been looking for all along. Are you hearing me? Oh, this is good news. You see, it's good news. That's why we call it part of his big picture. He wants us to know these things. Free will. Now, the proof that we've been given free will is that when Adam and Eve used their free will wrongly, we'll talk about that later, there were specific, dynamic, far-reaching consequences. You understand? It's like when we're raising our children, if we say, if you do such and such, oh, I don't even dare. Oh, I don't dare use examples out of my family. You have me arrested. Dear Jesus, we believed in consequences in my day. I don't know what we're teaching kids now. Nevertheless, whatever you say to your kids, do this. If you don't do this, or if you do this differently or disobey, these are the consequences. And then you really, because the consequences are so devastating, you really don't have the heart to follow through. You understand what I'm saying? You just don't have the heart to follow through. Sometimes we don't follow through because it inconveniences us to follow through. It's just easier to say, oh, well, let them do it. Not with God. When he gave us free will, and even when we chose to turn away from him, he let us experience our consequences without ever withdrawing his love from us. Hallelujah. 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 This is amazing. This is amazing. We're going to have to stop here, but let me just remind you, we've talked about God's person. Meditate on that. We've talked about his purpose. Oh, what a far-reaching purpose. But his plan, how is he going to pull off that purpose? How is he going to do it? Well, he's going to give us his divine life. He's going to breathe into us. He's going to provide an environment of provision and purpose. And he's going to allow us to exercise our own free will. Now, that's the beginning. We're beginning to see a pattern to the way God is working in this creation and human divine relationship thing. That is where we come in, because we're human and we are endeavoring to understand our created purpose, our relationship with God today. Oh, my friends, God's big picture lays out for you his plan for you. Even though our study has only begun, even from this moment, you begin putting yourself in God's plan, believing that his plan has never changed. You may not know how you can be restored to a Garden of Eden lifestyle of wonderful, peaceful harmony relationship with God, but I trust you to believe that if that's what he wanted in the beginning, that is what he provides today. Don't give up. God has your answer, and this is our time to choose how we're going to apply these truths in our lives. Would you just stand to your feet? Heavenly Father, I thank you because your truth prevails. It excites our hearts. It gives direction. It gives us insight into the divine creator of the universe, the great provider of our salvation. Gives us insight so that from this moment, we're as little children, knowing our parent, we know who you are, what you want, what you desire for us, and we just say, yes, Lord. Let it be to us according to your divine plan. We want to be part of your big picture. In Jesus' name, amen.